As a last speaker, I would request Mr. Akhil Sareen from Tata Power to please educate us on the age-old practices that Tata has learned on whatever new things you are trying to do.
Yeah, good morning, good afternoon, everybody. As far as data analytics technology is concerned, advancement in this sector is concerned, it is very, very important for every sector. And that is also the case true in the solar sector also, power sector also. Without advancement in technology, without use of data technology, no sector can survive in such a competitive environment. As far as if I talk about some decades before, it was very important to take a decision. People don't used to take a decision if for anything, any product you are buying, any service you are getting, you used to take a decision, it was considered worthful. After some time, the scenario changed. If few decades back, what happened? It was very important to take quality decision. Another Q got added to D and it was made quality decision. You may take some time in taking decision, but that decision should be quality decision. But now in present scenario, in this so much competitive environment, another Q has also been added to it and it is becoming QQD. You need to take quick quality decision. You can't, and for taking this quick quality decision, you need to rely on the information that you are getting. For getting this information, you need to take support of technology, you need to take support of data analytics, which is the source of information. Because only QQD decision, quick quality decision making can be taken only on the basis of information that you are getting. So in this sector also, this is for taking decision, information is required. We have tested use of technology in various fields in our power plants. Earlier talk was going about the module cleaning cycle also, soiling loss. What we have discovered, we can't even fix the module cleaning cycle as per, not on the basis of in state which our plant is located, not on the basis of the area, specific area, but it also depends upon the tables also. If we are, look, our few of the tables are located along the roadside or on the boundary of the fence, in that area a larger number of module cleaning cycles are required. So how we were able to gather this data with the help of applying technology and gathering data, how much losses we are getting, and even we, in some cases, we have come to a conclusion that even three module cleaning has to be implemented after every 3 to 4 days also. Earlier we used to do it in 15 days and there has been such much increase in our revenue after implementing module cleaning cycle in a span of 3 to 4 days also. Another dimension that has been also coming to the solar sector is the forecasting and scheduling regulations. Forecasting and scheduling regulations have been implemented in the state of Karnataka. They have also come in various other parts of the country. Rajasthan is about to start it from 1st February. DSM charges a large amount of penalties. And large bandwidth depends upon how you forecast your energy, how you forecast your solar power, how you forecast your wind energy. All these things depend upon your generation data. The generation data, if you're getting this data accurately, you will be able to predict handsomely. If you're not getting these details, you will not be able to predict. In the state of Chhattisgarh, if you talk, few of the developers are having a penalty to the tune of 30% of their rate of PPAs. Per month, they are getting penalties. So for another dimension of scheduling and forecasting, data analytics, data gathering is very much required. We have also studied some of the, even if we talk about the module efficiency, various module makers predict that efficiency will be given at the STC conditions. And STC conditions stand for temperature taken at the 25 degrees Celsius. But in Indian scenario, most of the time for the months of this May to August, we are getting temperature of around 40, 45. So there is a huge loss in this generation capacity. So with the deployment of various technologies and we have inbuilt some of the factors, we developed this and we implemented, planting of aloe vera, various gels we have appointed at our plants, and our efficiency and from the module generation has increased to substantial numbers, helping us in our revenue enhancement. Secondly, in security also, a lot plants are generally 5 acres is required for implementing of 1 megawatt of plant. So these plants are very huge capacities, and just of this around 7 to 10 security guards can't manage these plants. So we are also trying to have this security also webcams and various security features, advanced security features also get implemented at various plants, because security is also a very major issue these days. A lot of rural, because these plants are mostly located in the rural sector, and as far as you know, in changing scenario, few of the plants are having tariff of rupees 12 per unit, and whereas the people now expect a tariff of rupees 3 units, 3, 4 rupees. A lot of agitations, a lot of issues, community issues, civil issues are being cropping up. So as to another, we are also making use of technology in security sector also. Next is, for example, we have also implemented the use of technology. We have mostly our plants have fixed module structure. So, but with the advent of technology, we have also partnered with some of the foreign agencies. We are transforming our fixed angle into seasonal tilt and single axis tracking system. So it has also given, on the few of the pilot projects that we have implemented, they have given us around 30% increase in our revenue share from the same system itself. So for taking all these decisions, for managing these plants in a better way, technology is very, very much required these days. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for that spirited and very practical approach to O&M. Before opening up the dais to the questions from the audience, I had a couple of questions, and I'd like to start with you, Akhil sir, from where you left off. Operation and maintenance, in spite of usage of all the technology, in spite of usage of platforms, drones, everything else, is still a very hands-on manpower.
Various other activities that can be engaged in a solar power plant itself, vegetation, various other things you can go about this. One more thing I would like to add, if you permit. Yeah, I am also associated with IIT Delhi and also taking a research project for the this non-adoption of solar rooftop systems in residential sector. One of the, you will be shocked to hear this, we did a survey of South Delhi, and the awareness level among the people there about the solar rooftop systems was very drastically low. We keep on talking about the economics of solar power, we keep on talking about this. This is, yes, economics is one of the major factors. Payback period 4 to 5 years is impacting a lot of people in this adopting the solar systems, making them on the rooftops. But awareness is also a very, very crucial factor. People are not much aware of this solar rooftop system. And in the future, if our country needs to become energy security, we need to be an energy independent country, we need to adopt this system, and we need to spread awareness also. So we are taking this project, and also we are going to give, because after that we are going to give our this outcomes to MNRE. So one of our major outcomes that we have I've shared with you is the awareness level. We all need to work and spread awareness among people about the solar systems. We are into this industry, we know much about this thing, but as far as your urban people are concerned, they are not much aware about this solar rooftop systems. You need to educate people for the systems also and bring awareness in them. Thank you.
Great. That's super impressive. The way that, coming into the original part, which is to do with the security, the way that we have been trying to address it in the plants that we are managing is that we have got a separate budget for community development, wherein we are trying to educate the local villagers, provide them computer trainings, provide notebooks in schools, and such activities with which we are able to somehow ensure the community support to the plant as well, and of course, giving the local jobs when it comes to it. Coming from the more on-ground issues to another important issue, which is linked to the quality of modules, and is probably common to all the speakers that there are on stage. One part is to detect the issue with the quality of module, whether that be with portable EL testers, whether that be with the freebies that DuPont is offering in terms of free assessments, or with respect to locus or drones. That is one aspect, and probably that is the easier aspect. The other aspect is actually monitoring, administering the warranty and getting a replacement. If any of you on the stage, probably Gautam sir, could share some understanding on how exactly can we go about it and how successful can we do that, because that 4-page document of warranty, the fine print, practically guarantees that we'll never be able to get a replacement.
Yeah, the legal contract is a thing, you know, which is in the paper, but practically, if you want to see, you know, what I have told you, you know, so there are certain things that you have to take a preventive precautions. Say, for example, kind of the damage, you know, because of the micro crack which is creating, because of the transportation, because of the handling of these modules, you know. So this will come into the pictures, you know, because when it is non-performing or the power output is given low in the module, you know. So normally what happens in practice, there are three things is happening. One is that because of this mechanical damage, the yield testings, you know, like you can see the breakage. The other things is that LID and the PID, you know. So light induced degradations, you know, you have given in the first year 2.5%, but what happened if the cell is not PID resistive? PID free is a word, you know, that we use, but that is not actually happening, you know. I'm coming back to the, you know, device level, what is happening. It is a silicon that you make a kind of a, you know, rough surface through texturing, and after that you make a junctions, after that you make a kind of a oxide, thin oxide layer to prevent the sodium ion moving from the glass, you know, and after that there is a silicon nitride layer. So these layers are in the angstrom level, not even in the nanometer, you know. So you have to see that if the LID is a major factor that is coming into, as well as the PID as well, you know. So normally what happens, you know, if this kind of the issues come, then you appoint a third party, you know. But in the third party, you know, yield inspection is very easy, that you can check the crack. But if there is a power loss, the power loss has to, she, because of the what reasons, you know. So third party laboratory, when they measure the power, you know, for any kind of test, either the LID loss or the PID loss, the accuracy of the measurement is very, very critical. So which are the laboratory in India, the NIST is doing, the TUV is doing, but the accuracy level is ±3%. That means if you have a 320 watt modules, you know, so if there is, you measure the power, and this measurement, you have to see if it is on the third year, if this kind of the issue comes, you know. So you have to see that from the degradation pattern, like 2.5%, and then you have to add another 1.4, 3.9%, right? 3.9% plus the uncertainty of the measurement, you know, like 3% or particular laboratory. So overall, you know, so there is a almost like a 7% lower, sometimes it may come. So if you fight with this kind of a module manufacturer, so they will take, you know, the bottom line as well, you know. If it is much lower than that one, you know, so in that case you have to take into the legal account, I mean, like in the field, and then you have to say that there's a replacement, you know. But it doesn't cover up because of the handling and the other things, you know. So third party laboratory, one of the best laboratory that we are working is they called Fraunhofer laboratory, where uncertainty of measurements like 1.6%. That means instead of 3%, you know, some of the laboratory like TUV is giving 2.4%, 2.5%, but there are laboratories like PI Berlin also gives a, like, you know, almost 2.8%, less than 3%. But Fraunhofer is the best laboratory, you know, if you appoint them. But that is also costs a huge amount of money if there is a legal kind of a things is happens, you know.
Thank you so much for so that light. If the gentleman from DuPont could also talk about how effectively can we actually administer the warranty contract, and have there been any successful warranty claims that you have seen in the market where replacements have actually happened?
So actually, again, as I told you, we are not into O&M and we don't actually look at the contracts, but in terms of the experiences, we go in the field, interact with the people, the developers, the O&M companies, the people who are at the field. We get to understand that it's actually not a straightforward process. So definitely you have warranty documents, which again, as we're talking about, it's a piece of paper. But then what actually happens in the field, and in terms of the warranty claims, in terms of reporting, in terms of, again, measurement issues and all, because yes, it's true that there would be some measurement errors as well. And in terms of then going to a third party, because Mahindra guys told initially that they're going to get the lab accredited, because if they don't have it, they can't use it to claim warranties. Need to again go to approach a third party, which will take its own time to do the testing and then give you a report. So one thing is definitely in terms of what kind of warranty documents, what kind of clauses you have in your documents. Second thing is that when the issue occurs, then how you are going to claim it and how much time it's going to take. Because what I understand is that in case if it's take around 3 to 6 months, which is something what we have understood from the market, from the people who are owning plants, it typically takes 3 to 6 months to get a warranty claim. Then the 6 months loss, in case there's a power loss, will be borne by yourself. Module manufacturers are going to pay for that. And in second case, we have also seen is that depending on the size of the customer as well in the future prospects of that customer in terms of doing business. In a lot of cases, we have seen that the module manufacturer will typically not replace modules, especially if the size of the plant is not very big. Yes, if it's a big customer, if the plant size is 50 megawatt plus, definitely since they know that they're going to come back with you in terms of module orders, they will service those claims. But if the plant size is very low or they know that you're not a very big player, typically we have seen that they will typically try to kind of avoid your calls as well. And then if it's proven that there's an issue out there, then they won't typically replace all the modules as well. So these are the practical issues which we have heard from the market. We haven't experienced by ourselves because, as I told you, we are not this into business. But this is what we are hearing from the market. And definitely there's a lot of difference in terms of what we have in your documents versus what you claim.
Thank you, that's interesting. So basically, if you want to claim a warranty, you better be prepared with a very large order the next time that you want to give with a module supplier. Otherwise, it's a high chance that he might not give you your due importance. When it comes to the platform, I wanted to understand something. So India is a unique geography and has its own unique constraints. We have got limited connectivity. I'm not being able to check my emails even here properly. Considering the on-ground challenges of data acquisition, whether it comes to connectivity, whether it comes to poor installation, communication cables not working, or the quality of communication cables not being good enough, or the quality of sensors not being good enough, how is Locust navigating its way across the Indian installations?
Thank you for the question, Puneet. So one of the first things that we do is invest into the hardware. So the data acquisition hardware that you install at any site, it needs to be industrial grade. There are many data loggers, many cell modems available that are that may last you through the first 2 years. But beyond that, investing into something, in terms of the hardware, what we do is store and push mechanism so that even in the case of data connectivity loss, you do not miss out on any data. All that data is continuously being logged at the site. Once the data is onto the server, the next challenge is to be able to indicate to the user where on the plant are there any wiring issues or any data loss issues. So there we have a complex set of alerts that we create to be able to apprise the user of where or what devices are not functioning over and above what the device might already be alerting. So there's the first level which the device automatically tells you, and there's a overarching layer which we run to find out if there's any other issue besides what the device is telling us. So that is in terms of the data acquisition. In terms of how SCADA approach is there, I think one of the gentlemen in the morning mentioned that we should be investing more into the SCADA software, and yes, because you have installed a plant which is going to run for a long time, you cannot spend time or resources after every few years trying to reinvent the whole thing or to install or get it modified every time. So whenever you invest into a SCADA or a monitoring system, one of the key things that you have to keep in mind is how reliable is it, how long lasting it is it, and how robust is the hardware as well as the software. I hope that answers.
Right. So we have been facing this problem in almost all the plants that we are managing. We are managing 2,000 megawatts, out of which 1,500 megawatts do not have SCADA. And whenever we are approaching a client in order to get that SCADA system installed, more often than not, the plant had a SCADA at some point of time and has got dysfunctional. So we have got a thumb rule. The thumb rule is that whenever you go to a site and you see a D-Link router that you typically install at your homes, consider that to be a disaster and you might have to replace the SCADA from start all over again. Right? So that's what we have done. We have got our own platform called Procento that we have developed, and this is the same issue that we face over there. Coming into the drones, which is the most fancy part of the presentation, I would imagine that drones, as I had probably indicated, is as much of a technology problem in India as it is a legal problem. Have you had any instances of farmers trying to throw stones at you because you were trying to fly over their lands? And how have you actually taken care of that? In more serious context, there is, I believe, a DGCA policy which is coming out anytime soon, which will allow formally legally the use of drones in the Indian airspace. How do you see that turning out? What kind of constraints you imagine are going to be on players like us?
Yeah, so we did face a few issues. I won't mention the state or the place, but we didn't faced some issues, and we had to abort a few missions because farmers just refused to let us even step on the land, let alone fly over the land. And with regards to the regulations, DGCA has released a draft set of regulations which are up to the mark when it comes to the global standards, but there are some shortfalls which will constrain us when it comes to doing visual surveys. So, but as far as O&M surveys are concerned using thermal drones, so the restriction is with respect to the height that you can fly at. So globally, the standard is anything below 400 feet is kosher, is fine. And you don't need to take any special permission from the local ATC or whatever. But in India, they made that that restriction to be 200 feet, which severely restricts us when it comes to doing visual surveys. But as far as thermal surveys are concerned, there's not going to be any issue because we fly at a much lower height. There are some there are also some conditions with respect to importing drones. For a company like Sensehawk, where we deal with drones day in and day out, it makes sense to register ourselves and register our drones. But I'm not sure how it's going to impact the wider usage of drones, because in the end, we want O&M operators to own their own drones, to have drones on every site. And if there's going to be a lot of regulation when it comes to just bringing in drones, it might still be a bit of a challenge. But we will cross that river when it comes eventually.
Amazing. Thank you so much. With this, I'd like to open the floor to the audience. If you have any questions in the audience, please.
My question is to Karthik. Instead of drone, just a thought, why can't we have an aerostat model kind of thing? It's either down to the earth. I have my own camera also, and I can rotate it 360 degrees. So why couldn't you think of those?
Yeah. So there might be a couple of technical issues there. We need to do a little bit of exploration with regards to that idea. But the thing about drones is that you don't need one drone. Per site, you can take a drone from one site, take it to another site, and you can reuse the hardware. And the way that we do our survey is that we cover the entire area of interest by flying in an overlapping manner. So we fly in a zigzag fashion, such that each photo is like the panorama shot that you take on your phone. So each photo needs to overlap with the next photo. So that's why a drone basically it covers the entire field more or less. So I would imagine that a sort of a suspended camera would be very difficult to move it along on a aerially. So drones are perfect for the kind of at least in terms of data collection, drones are just made for the application. So
just to add to that, sir, what I imagine is that in order to map a single point, a drone ends up taking photographs. Just to convert what Karthik was saying into simple speech, a drone needs to click photographs from multiple angles so that it knows the exact 3D coordinate of that particular point. If you have got a stationary camera at one place, it might not be able to do that very effectively. That and the economic angle wherein a drone can distribute its costs over 50 plants in a year vis-a-vis an aerostate model doing that over a single site. Right, so that combines makes the drones a little better. There are also, by the way, aeroplanes which are now being used to do that. Instead of 20 megawatts per day, they're able to do 400 megawatts per day. Might be more relevant to some of the large solar parks that we are having. Any more questions from the audience, please?
Yeah, sorry, since drone is the buzzword and a lot of questions around that, I'll just like to add to what Wing Commander asked. So drones is just a platform. It basically is carrying sensors, which is used to scan the data and take that data. And like Karthik started out, we are more around data analytics company where we can handle most type of image data, thermal data, geographic data. So through whatever platform it is connected, our aim is to make sense of that data and then give it to enterprises where their decision makers can take decisions. And the reason for using drones is eventual outlook is, since right now there is no policy around that, we are offering it as a turnkey solutions. But our engagement model with a lot of engineering companies as well is they own this hardware, they collect data and use our platforms, like the reports and all which you've seen, is use our platform to essentially process the data. So that's where you have your own data, you have control over the data, where you want to process that and eventual outlook. So right now, just because there is no full stack and this is a new technology where organizations are also learning what things they can solve, how they can modify their existing business processes. So it's all around that.
Thank you, Viral. Thank you.
Hi, my question is to Neeraj, because you operate a lot of solar plants which are new and old, a large mix of assets. So my question is on the waste disposal on module side. Because you generate a lot of damaged modules which are physically damaged during the installation and then operation maintenance period. So what, and I believe you must be adopting IMS procedures for your assets. So what, an IMS procedure basically, I mean, it focuses more, much more on the waste disposal part. So what is the practice you adopt for the module disposals?
First of all, I'm Akhil. Neeraj, Mr. Neeraj Agarwal is not available. I'm at on his
behalf. Akhil.
No, not a problem. Yeah, a lot of modules and a lot of this waste is coming these days for modules also. Presently, what we are doing, for example, they have a lot of degraded modules or some efficiency is poor. So we are using that modules for various other purposes. You can use them, these modules, for reducing your auxiliary consumption. You can reduce this module for running your bore well or other plants. And as far as modules that are totally damaged, that can't be done. So we are having this discussion with a few of the agencies to have a disposal with all their legal consents and everything. Because this is something, a legal case also, like these days, because disposing is not and so such in a clear framework there in the how to dispose of this. So we are using these modules which are degraded, but as far as which are totally damaged, we have kept it aside and we are in a discussion phase with few other agencies.
Hello, I'll throw some light, you know. So looking to the technology, like, you know, 90% what we are using the crystalline silicon, but there are certain technology where cadmium telluride is the module, you know. So you have to see that how cadmium and telluride is a kind of a the toxic element, you know, which are going to cause damage to the environment, you know. So any this kind of a installations where this module, you know, when you're handling, you know, so there is a SOP, you know, how to handle this kind of a, it's not even in the bare head, you know. So these modules has to, in fact, you know, First Solar, I think they have a kind of a policy, like, you know, how to take back on the legal contract, you know, how to handle, you know. So these are the definitely issue, you know, if it is in a, there are different forum, you know, like if this kind of a, the rejected modules, you know, how it should be handled, you know, how it should be protected, you know, from the environment. So crystalline silicon is very easy, you know, the glass which is coming, you know, you can take out and there are some EVA and the backseat, you know, tiddler, you know, it's very easy. And the silicon is a material where it gets in the silicon oxide, silicon dioxide. So sand is a kind of, it's coming from the sand, you know. But cadmium and this kind of a thing, and even in the CIGS, you know, kind of a technology where there is a method that it should be handled very carefully, it should be protected, you know, from the environment, and there is a EHS team, you know, that is working on that, you know. So that way, I think that the waste disposal has to be, you know, very carefully done.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for that, sir.
Yeah. Hello.
Considering that Anand sir is on stand, I'm not sure, do we have another question time or not?
Okay. Yeah. Right. Hello. My name is Inder Meet. Sorry, I'm not from solar industry. From Cathrine, it's basically into RFID solutions. So I've been, you know, talking about assets and O&M, but I hardly seen, you know, RFID being discussed around it. This question is for the panels and the industry, you know, experts who are sitting in this room. Guys, do you see any challenge in RFID, or you want us to improve in some use cases? Like you said, drones have been used. We want us to hang some RFID readers on drones and, you know, use on the big plants, big, you know, assets tracking or maybe recording of this O&M applications.
Does anybody want to take this up, or?
One input is that if you like them over, because I have seen any plant can within 5 years, 5 hours, it will be formed. The idea is to get protect or kind of store it from which.
Yeah, so one of the things that I would maybe give an input around is that increase the lifetime, because I believe that the modules which are coming from China, they don't have RFIDs inside. So definitely the RFID is a very important aspect, and you were right that we should have discussed that. But then the thing is that, and definitely in terms of doing performance analysis after maybe a few years, because typically with respect to power data, what you have on nameplate, it could be there could be a difference in terms of what you have in the nameplate versus what you have in the IP curve. But then typically life of the RFID would be very less. So what I've seen in the field is that within a span of 2 to 3 years, RFID will be completely degraded. It will be kind of coming out from the module and it would be of no use. So this is one of the inputs that I can give to you.
So I think it was a wonderful session, and a lot of sincere thought process and a lot of knowledge sharing has happened. So thank you very much. Let's give a big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, to the distinguished panelists and speakers at the stage. I'd like to move on and request Mr. Puneet to hand over some small mementos to all the... Yeah, on the request of Mr. Puneet, I'll request Mr. Gautam to kindly do the honors and hand over the mementos to all the speakers on the stage.
Thank you.